Washington and Manila's joint military patrols enter its third day. The aircraft of the Philippines and U.S. Air Force flew over the vicinity of Batanes Province and other areas of the country's waters. The navies of both countries also tried a U.S. maritime patrol craft capable of intelligence and surveillance operations. The two allies are set to end their patrols in the West Philippine Sea today, November 23rd.
And we're going to be providing eyes in the sky, what we call intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. Take the opportunity to coordinate and do maritime cooperation activities with the Filipino Navy is just a great strategic opportunity to show all of our allies and partners in this Indo-Pacific region that we're here. We're willing to operate and to strengthen those partnerships. To provide safety and to provide security in this region and ensure everybody's abiding by the international law.
The Philippine Army meanwhile clarifies the joint activities are not meant to escalate tensions with China.
China should know that we are just implementing international law and convention, and all our actions are in accordance with international convention. So China has no need to react on this because it's not meant against any country. It is just that we are asserting, it is just us asserting our sovereign rights and jurisdiction in areas that are within our maritime zone.
A state of calamity has been declared in the Philippine province of Northern Samar, which has been battered by days of torrential rains and floods. The full story from Sharon Evite.
Flood-ravaged residents of the town of Lope de Vega in Northern Samar are busy clearing their properties. Others focused on repairing their damaged homes or salvaging usable materials after incessant rains triggered flash floods. Many say flood waters rose quickly, inundating roads and villages.
Kagabi, madaling araw, mga alas dos ata, umano yung bahay kaagad. Kaya nagtakbuhan kami doon, hindi namin nadala lahat yung gamit namin.
It's a double whammy at least for this resident, who had to throw away some of the water-damaged goods he was selling. Despite the hardships brought by floods, residents of Lope de Vega are thankful they can now sort out their belongings and clean up their homes. On Tuesday, 24 villages were flooded. Currently, the road from Lope de Vega to Catarman is passable. However, due to several landslides along the way, vehicles need to take turns to pass through. Vehicles were stranded on Tuesday due to multiple landslides. The entire Northern Samar province is now under a state of calamity. Flooding has affected an estimated 74,000 families. In Northern Samar, large vehicles cannot pass through the Dangkalan Bridge in Bubon after it sustained some cracks due to the flood. Flood waters have receded in parts of Catarman, one of the hard-hit areas. Over 350 families are still staying in modular tents at the provincial capital. Still in Northern Samar, houses and roads in San Roque have also been damaged, while rice fields are still inundated. The town of Hipapad, Eastern Samar, has also been placed under a state of calamity. After all of its 13 villages were flooded, residents are appealing for clean water, medicine, and food. Sharon Avita, ABS-CBN News.
Let's get an update on the weather now from PAGASA forecaster Rhea Torres. Hi, Rhea.
Hello, good morning to everyone. As of the update for the weather in our country for the next 24 hours, the shear line continues to affect portions of southern Luzon, bringing cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms over Palawan, Quezon, and Bicol region. Therefore, for our citizens over said areas, they are still warned against possible flash floods or landslides due to moderate to at times heavy rains. Meanwhile, the northeast monsoon continues to prevail and affect large portions of Luzon, bringing cloudy skies with light rains over Batanes, Cagayan, Isabela, and Apayao. Meanwhile, for Metro Manila and the rest of Luzon, generally fair weather conditions are also expected, besides chances of isolated light rains. And for the rest of the country, particularly over Visayas and Mindanao, we're expecting improving weather conditions, especially for areas in Visayas. And however, there are still chances of isolated rain showers or thunderstorms, usually by the afternoon or the evening. And since we are also not monitoring any low-pressure area or tropical cyclone within and outside our Philippine area of responsibility, fair weather conditions will still persist over large portions of the country over the next few days. We also do not have any gale warning raised over any seaboards of the country. However, caution is still advised over seafarers over the seaboards of Luzon since moderate to rough coastal waters are still expected. And that is the latest here from Pag-asa Weather Forecasting. This is Rhea Torres reporting.
Thank you very much for that update, Rhea. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. calls for unity in fighting global warming and climate change. He made that appeal during the observance of the Climate Change Consciousness Week. Marcos pointed out the climate crisis has become more evident in the present time. He urged the Climate Change Commission and the public to work together in protecting the environment. Marcos will travel to the United Arab Emirates next week to attend the COP 2023 with other world leaders. They are expected to tackle ways on how to mitigate global emissions to limit the effects of climate change. So Philippine lawmakers weigh resolutions urging government to cooperate with the International Court's probe on the bloody drug war of the Duterte administration. Three resolutions are currently filed in the House asking government to allow the ICC to investigate the brutal anti-narcotics campaign. But the lawmakers behind the move clarify the resolutions are not a form of retaliation against the former president.
If we follow the rule of law, kung talagang susunod natin ang rule of law, kailangan tayo mag-cooperate sa ICC investigators.
Meanwhile, the allies of former President Duterte continue to shrug off the development. Senator Ronald De La Rosa says the resolutions mean nothing as long as President Marcos does not act on it. The president's sister, Senator Amy Marcos, agrees.
Ipapasa pa daw yung ICC resolution na pakialaman tayo ng dayuhan samantalang mga korte natin na papatunayan naman na maandar, malaya at matibay.
Former Malacanang spokesperson Harry Roque alleges bias on the part of the judge who granted bail to former Philippine Senator Leila De Lima. Roque says Judge Jener Guito was De Lima's favorite student at the San Beda College of Law. This was echoed by former Justice Chief Vitaliano Aguirre, who, like Roque, was a member of the Duterte cabinet. Roque believes Guito's alleged association with De Lima is a valid basis for the judge to inhibit from the former senator's last drug case. Guito allowed De Lima to post bail on November 13th and set her free from nearly 7 years in detention.
Kasi nga dapat maiwasan ang lahat ng bagay na magkakaroon ng aninlangan ng taong bayan na isang desisyon ay hindi patas. Dapat dinisclose at hinayaang magdesisyon ang public prosecutors mag-decide kung sila'y mamumove for inhibition on that ground.
The Philippine Solicitor General says he does not see any conflict of interest on Judge Guito's part. Minardo Guevara explains a judge would not need to inhibit if he believes his relation to the respondent does not affect his impartiality.
If I were a judge for example, this favorite student of mine would appear, it doesn't follow
that you have to inhibit.
Papaboran ko siya simply because at one time he was my favorite student.
So if the
judge were a very fair judge, it wouldn't really matter.
Okay.
Yeah. Kahit nakilala niya yan, favorite niya, it wouldn't really matter kung talagang fair naman yung judge. Yeah.
Meanwhile, information from the Polytechnic University of the Philippines, where Guito was a former faculty member, indicates that he never studied at the San Beda College of Law.